because of, you know, sorry about that. They're not disadvantaged from achieving their full health potential because of factors such as age, disability, gender identity, sexual orientation, race and ethnicity, the neighborhood you live in, and perhaps how much money you make. And so equality and equity are not actually the same. Equality gives everyone the same resources to reach the same opportunities, while equity gives people the resources they need so that they have the same opportunities as everyone else. So we know that these inequities have always existed and been a part of the healthcare system, but COVID-19 has highlighted inequities. And so as stated by Ross, you know, the Engross Substitute Senate Bill 5229 was passed in 2021, and it requires that healthcare professionals must take continuing education on health equity. And the goal really is to have providers think about their own impact on others, and it can change the way we work with others so that we can reduce inequities. Now, today we'll be working on the rules. January 1st, 2023, secretary professions must adopt these rules. And then in July 1st, 2023, DOH will identify a free training based on these model rules. So these model rules, like we said, is really defining the minimum standard. People who provide trainings and professionals alike can actually obtain training that exceeds these minimum standards. And then by January 1st, 2024, boards and commissions must adopt rules surrounding health equity, continuing education. They have multiple options. Maybe they adopt the same rules that we developed today. They go through their own rulemaking process and identify and develop rules surrounding continuing health education, or maybe they do a hybrid of both. And I know that a lot of the boards and commissions have been in attendance, both the listening sessions and the rules workshops. But right now we're going to be working on developing that first set of model rules that our secretary professions need to adopt. So what are those professions? Well, those are professions that don't have a board of commission. Typically, they have an advisory committee, but they do have a CE requirement. So this will not include our agency affiliated counselors or other professions that don't have a CE requirement. And with that, we'll kind of move forward, and more will be revealed as we begin. But I wanted to hand it over to Mina a little bit to talk about the listening session data. So I'll stop sharing my screen, and Mina, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Ashley. Hi everyone, my name is Mina. I am the Eilers epidemiologist, and I am assisting with some of the data from the listening sessions as well as the rules workshops. So for those of you who were not able to join us, or if you were, I just wanted to go over a brief summary of what we heard throughout all four of the listening sessions that we heard. So a lot of participants were for and in favor of early training, and that included things maybe like implicit bias training, a more diverse workforce, access to healthcare profession education, addressing systemic and systematic issues, patient welfare outside of the medical setting. We heard a lot of participants sharing their experiences based on racial and ethnic inequities, and that included care for refugees. We saw a lot of participants sharing experiences based on sexual orientation or gender identity. We saw participants sharing experiences based on inequitable treatment rooted in their language or culture being different from their provider, as well as experiences based on access difficulties, and those could be either financial or physical. folks shared that they had experiences that they felt were inequitable based on their ability status, as well as a lot of issues associated with stigma surrounding mental health and substance use challenges. And there was a concern for distrust for providers, regardless of other demographic factors.
Thank you for sharing. It's going to be very important that we take what we learned from our listening session and make sure that we can integrate it as best as we can within the confines of what this bill states. And so with that being said, if we could have a policy analyst share the draft rules, and just to make it clear, we put these draft rules together so that we can have some type of guidepost, so that when we develop these rules, we'll be able to look at what's actually there and make some decisions regarding whether or not we want to keep a section. Maybe we need to add a section. Things are very flexible. And so before we begin, we'll talk also a little bit about what may have asked some further questions on, whether or not we have the authority to address this or how we are able to address this if we decide to. So what I'll do today is we'll go through line after line. I'll look for some feedback and really just call on some people to speak when you raise your hand. Remember, please keep the conversation on track. Think about who is participating or who may be listening. And really, let's guide our comments towards making this rule something that we can implement. And so with that, we'll go on the first section. And some more feedback on background is part 13 is the minimum standards for suicide trainings. In opening up this rule, we opened up the same section. And so this would be part 14. And really it's the minimum standards for healthcare, health equity continuing education, and it relates to healthcare professionals. And so everything is a new section. This does not exist. And we might have some typos, but we really wanted to, like I said, create a framework without actually directing the rules. And we tried to include what the bill must have as a minimum. So with that, let's start the discussion. And the first one is what we would call WAC 246-12-700, and it's really centered around the purpose. And so hopefully we had some individuals, we sent out a draft copy of the rules that you could read over. And does anyone have any comments, any thoughts? Do we want to define what the purpose is of this bill as well?
Hey, Ashley, I just want to make sure everyone is able to see the rule. Can we, if anyone is having any difficulty or anything like that, I just want to make sure it's visible to everyone.
All right, we're getting some positive feedback in the comment section.
Okay, great.
Can you post the doc in the chat for download is what we're being asked. And someone else asked, can you zoom in a bit? That would be great. So Dan, I'm not sure if you're able to share the draft rules.
Yep, I could do that, but I got some hands up too. So do you want, can someone else do the hand piece while I send that out?
Yes. To be honest, I cannot see the hands up though. Very, very interesting.
And it looks like they have been lowered. So I'm not sure.
Okay.
But yes, I could send that out here in a second.
If you have, so what we thought of here was, what is the purpose of this bill, right? A lot of the suicide prevention training rules, they have this section called purpose. And this is similar for a lot of rules. They define kind of what that scope is. And so what we did is we said the purpose is to set minimum standards for health equity, continuing education programs for healthcare professionals. Both. So the definitions. So as a disclaimer, we took a lot of the definitions as they were defined in the original bill. And so are we missing any definitions? Do they need to have some clarity? And right here, I noticed that the references are a little off, Ross. They say 600. So perhaps we can make some comment boxes to, or we can make some changes. Any questions, comments? Ross?
Well, and just to clarify these, the numbers, I think as Ashley had mentioned that we're referencing here, we're creating a new section in WAC chapter 246.12 that we're, you know, at this point calling 700. So when we're changing these references, we're just ensuring it's consistent with the rest of the numbering for this new chapter that we're creating.
Yeah. So we define department. We'll go ahead and move down. We defined what a health professional is. Now, this is individual licensed. Do we want to change that? Gail, you have your hand up. Go ahead and unmute and speak.
Thank you. I'm sorry, I didn't mean to interrupt you, Ashley. You were probably going to make the comment I was going to make here, that I would recommend you say an individual credentialed rather than licensed, because healthcare professionals are either licensed, certified, or registered. So I would change that to be healthcare professional means an individual credentialed or holding a retired active credential in that definition.
Okay. Do we have any thoughts agreeing with that or maybe different views? We have a comment in chat that says, good point, I agree. All right. Yes, perfect. And use only one word. Someone said, you can be credentialed in something and not have to take a CE.
Right, and that's why you need that language at the end, so that it's just not that the profession shows up in the list in the RCW, but that it's only those professions listed that have a continuing education requirement.
Does anyone else have any more comments on this? Then I'm seeing the chat, so I'm also logging those comments in, by the way. Some people say a license, registered and credentialed. Some say credentialed under that specific RCW. And the third one would be, it would be great to have consistency with other WACs that refer to these groups of professionals, if there is any. So something I can do and have prepared for you next section, so workshop number two, is I can also look up, and so maybe Ross, if you can add a comment there, to do some research and see how other WACs that refer to these groups of individuals perhaps define that definition. So we have some really good comments. Let's move down to Modelist. And Gal, you said you had some comments surrounding the Modelist as well.
Oh, just one. And maybe there's a reason for it and I don't understand it. The statute you cited was the suicide prevention training. And would I be correct that you want to cite, oh, wait, did you update it? No, yeah, 7442. Oh, you updated it. It's different than the version I have. So perhaps you corrected it. I think you corrected it. So never mind. Never mind. Thank you.
Yeah, and it might have been an oversight or something that maybe Ross went through. I know you went, Ross went through as well as Hope to try to get those references correct.
Yeah.
Does anyone else have any or comments on model less than the definition we use for that? Seeing none, no comments, and no hands raised. Let's talk about structural competency. So this was also defined in the legislation. And I guess some of the initial questions I have is, do we want to change that definition? Do we want to leave it? Or I guess there's two. Do we want to leave it as is, change it? All right, Gal, you have your hand up.
Yeah, I just wanted to point something out, and I'm going to defer to your Assistant Attorney General. But the question I would ask is, when you have a definition in statute, can you change it in rule? So I'm not sure. I'm not used to seeing that happen, but I'm going to defer to your legal counsel. I just wanted to raise the question.
Right. Can we go ahead, Ross, and just put that question in there? Make a note. And so then with that note, we'll also go ahead and hold over the other definitions, Ross, that were taken from the bill language. Someone said, I do find it confusing. However, I think it should match the statute. And that's why I was going to ask, is the definition might be confusing to some. But we'll ask that question and hopefully we'll have the response before the second workshop. If not, then I will bring it forward on the third one and we can work on that.
And actually, I guess I would also just add, sorry, this is Ross, as another option of whether we need these definitions in rule. They are already included in statute. And, you know, if it benefits folks to have this in the rule as opposed to just referring to it in statute. So just putting that out there is maybe another option.
Yeah, let's explore that option as well. Does everyone attending agree with that? Do you have some concerns of it not even being in the rule and just leaving it in statute? I see no comments so far. So Ross, if you'll take me, take us beyond. Oh, wait, we do have a hand up. Go ahead, Hanny.
Hi, I'm wondering if I reread it and I don't find it all of that confusing, particularly the structural competence, but you could expand on those to clarify what those mean for people who may be confused by it and leave them in the rule. I think that makes it much more digestible for people who have to implement.
Thank you for those comments. And we do have one in the comment box too. It's useful to have it repeated and match the statute to help clarify. Michelle, you have your hand up too.
Yeah, sorry, it took me a minute to find my unmute myself. I have a question about cultural safety. I guess I need to begin that question with, how is culture defined? Because I'm confused about how the term cultural safety or culture is being used thematically, but might also limit the ability to capture other forms of oppression that culture alone does not capture when we talk about the self-analysis or self-conscious awareness of biases.
Any other comments on that? Omar, do you have something to add to that?
Nothing to add, but I'm on board with kind of diving deeper into the definition.
So it sounds like the first thing we're going to need to do is ask the question that needs to be asked to the AAG. And then also, you know, I would kind of like to ask a little bit more, how would you define cultural safety? Or even take a deeper dive into that, how that word cultural is used. Annie, I'm not sure if your hand's up again or if you have any comments.
Apology, I forgot to put it back down.
I'll let you guys sit there with that, and then we'll go ahead and move to the next definition. Oh, those are the only definitions. So I would ask, do we need to add any more definitions to this? And perhaps Ross, it will help maybe if you explain a little bit about when we define something and it, et cetera.
I'm not sure if I have a great explanation. I mean, definition sections for our rules are helpful to explain key terms that we're using throughout the rule chapter. So as we're moving through the rest of the rule, if there is terminology that anyone thinks is confusing or ambiguous, that might be a good term to flag for a definition, unless there's any other terms that you think at this point would be necessary to define just as a general rule. Does that help, Ashley?
That does. There's some comments. Health scare. Third line from the top, health scare organizations. From the bottom. Oh, I see it. Third line from the bottom. All right. Good catch. Really good catch. So we have a question in the chat. How would cultural safety get at or measure forms of oppression, such as sex, gender, sexuality, ability, race, et cetera, that are not cultural in origin? Will you be expanding the definition of cultural safety to include forms of oppression outside of ethnocentrism? That's a great question. And I'm gonna actually let everyone answer that. since it's not my job to necessarily define what those are, but really just to get curious and ask. And so I'm going to open that question in chat to kind of everyone. And I'm also going to call on Omar and say, hey, Omar, do you have any further thought on that as well?
Yeah, but I think I'm going to wait for folks in chat first, and then maybe I offer a couple things after.
Okay. Anything, any hands up, anything in chat? We do have agreements that it does need to be expanded on, at least in the definitions, to be more inclusive. I don't see anything else in the chat, Omar, other than agreed.
Yeah, and I think that based off some of the other comments that were made is getting at, like, how are we defining cultural safety? And if it's not encompassing the other factors that don't fall under ethnocentrism, as someone mentioned, maybe broadly defining what else is included within this that isn't culturally, what does cultural mean, really?
So I think what I'm going to do with this is we're going to ask, can we change this definition? And then look at if the answer is yes, then we can come back and have more discussion on how do we include definitions that are more inclusive. Someone said, would it be helpful to include a definition of health equity in this section as well? And that definition should also address health equity. All right. So I guess in that question, would it be helpful to include a definition of health equity? I guess the question is, would it be useful? We do have one agree. And if we do include that definition, how do we define health equity? So during our listening sessions, one of the questions was, how do you define health equity? And we also got a wide range of answers, depending on who answered that question. Now we have the DOH definition of health equity, but is there any other definition we need to take into consideration? Someone did post the link of cultural safety in the chat. How about culture or health equity? Susan, is your comment towards the definition from the link? Okay, perfect. So Ross, it's going to be important too that we go back and look at that link as well. And I'm not sure if you're able to just copy and paste. You are.
I'm not sure if we're going to be able to, we may have to just put that in the URL. It's there in the document.
Thank you. Well, let's move on. What was the next section? Gel.
Yes, the new set, the next section is the program requirements.
Yes, hi again, Gail McGaffick. Just a couple technical things to consider here. Under subsection one, it's a similar comment to what I made in the definition of health professional, because it says each health profession under must complete, and it isn't each one. It's only those that have a continuing education requirement. So you'll just want to clarify that similarly to what was done for the health professional definition. And I have a couple others, but I can pause right there.
Okay. And you'll notice that it says XX hours in health equity. I do have some questions surrounding that. But we'll have a discussion about that in particular after the break. One of the comments does say, does the RCW define that it must be every 4 hours? And Ross, I'm kind of gonna, or 4 years. And Ross, I'll defer to you.
Yes, it is in the ESSB 5229. I don't have the citation off the top of my head, but it does specify that it is every 4 years.
Gail, why don't you go ahead with all your other comments?
Okay, and I wanted to point out subsection three first, and because you've got training must be provided in accordance with each health profession's rules for continuing education. And you might, and I overlooked this the first time I read it, you might want to look back then on your purpose section where you've pretty much said the same thing. But I pointed out in this section, because in subsection two, you've got as determined by the health profession, and I think it would be more clearer to mirror the language in subsection three and say each health profession's rules for continuing education. And I can say that again if I combined it with too many things.
For me, I think if you could repeat that, Gal.
You bet. Yeah, and my apologies for making it too complicated. So just looking at subsection two, I think it would be more clear at the end of the sentence to say health education. Oh, I'm sorry. You know, I guess this was my own add-in. So my bad. No wonder I made it confusing. So subsection two, other continuing education training courses may satisfy the minimum requirements for continuing education. I think it should be training. And then I wonder if you want the words as determined by the relevant health professions rules on continuing education. My apologies.
Oh, no problem.
I apologize, Gail. Could you repeat that last?
Oh, and that's suggestion? Okay. You bet. I'm thinking that subsection two would be more clear if we start the first line, other continuing education training programs may satisfy the minimum requirements for health equity continuing education. I think it should be training rather than topics, as determined by the relevant health professions rules for continuing education. Or you could put each, you could sync the language as similar to subsection three.
Thank you.
Yeah, thank you for asking.
All right, so Gail, you said something with section three or point three.
Right. Okay, I'll go back. And I just noticed this and I've read this three times. So it just occurred to me that subsection three, when you say training must be provided in accordance with each health profession's rules for continuing education, very important information. That line essentially is also in the purpose section in 700, the very first new section. And so it just made me think that you probably don't need that last sentence or that sentence in the purpose section. So maybe just look at both of those, and because to me, where it is in subsection three is probably the best place for it. So just something to think about. And sorry, I didn't notice that until I was just reading it again right now.
Oh, that is 100% fine. This is what the workshops are for. And I see a hands up from Jesse. Do you have any comments?
Well, I had a question, and forgive me if this is dense, but in number two, where it says other continuing education training courses may satisfy the minimum requirements, does that mean courses other than those that are on the model list?
So,
what does other mean?
No, and it's a perfectly great question. The thought pattern behind this, and perhaps it needs to be, you know, a little written differently, and there was some great suggestion already, but sometimes the continuing education that a professional would take would also meet the minimum requirements as written in training topics here. And so what this is doing is saying, hey, we recognize that. And so if you're taking other continuing educations that meet the minimum standards as written here, that would apply. Ross, am I missing anything in that explanation?
No, I think that's right. I think what we were discussing is just the kind of double dipping idea. Is that right? Where if there's other courses that a professional might be taking to satisfy their continuing education credit, and that happens to also touch on health, you know, the standards that come out of this rulemaking and satisfy both, that I think we were hoping to not preclude a professional getting credit for both topics, the health equity and whatever other subject they were taking a course on, but that's, you know, certainly what we hope to discuss today and get input on and see if that fits within this rulemaking.
I hope that answered your question, and please don't hesitate to interject if you need more clarification.
It does answer. I'm not sure I would understand that if I was reading the WAC, but I'd be interested in other people's thoughts, because maybe that's just a me problem.
Would it benefit to maybe rewrite or clarify that more in that rule? Because that's really important. There's a comment that says yes. This might be a great point actually for us to take a break. So let's take a 10-minute break, or actually let's define, let's take a break until 10 after. So at 3:10, we'll return here. I'll mute myself and turn off my camera. And then when we're to begin again, I'll turn my camera back on and start off. And I will put in the chat when we come back. So let's take a break. Okay, it is 3:10 p.m. Right. So let's start. We do have a few sections to get through today, as well as one section that I think most individuals are interested in, which is the content of the training. But I wanted to go back up and ask about the hours. So there's been a little bit of discussion about this, and the bill actually doesn't lay out how many hours. And so just to keep it in mind, there's been talk about two different ways in which we can address this. We can define hours per topic, or we could define just hours in general. It's important to note that, and maybe Ross, you can correct me, or Hope even, there's multiple ways to do this. But the boards and commissions could, in theory, also set their own hours too. So right now we're looking at these professions that don't have a board or commission that are eligible or required to take continuing education. So this can be licensees, this can be individuals who are registered or who receive a certification. But really defining how many hours do we need to complete in health equity topics. And so I'm not sure. And so someone asked, do we need to specify hours, or could that be left to the professional organizations? And that's a great question. So when we talk about rulemaking and defining what these hours are, it really depends on how that organization really opens up the rules. Ross, I'll let you kind of clarify, or Hope, that question that's in the chat a little bit more. Do we need to specify the hours? And then someone said, how often do they need to take the training? They must, which means you then have to demonstrate or show, typically in the form of certificates, that you have taken this educational training over the course of the 4 years. So I'll kind of hand it off to my policy people.
Hi, Ashley. Yeah, I think what you said makes sense. All I would add is that I think 5229, the bill, is relatively clear that boards and commissions would probably specify for their professions what minimum standards they're adopting, and what, more than likely, what the hours would be, but I guess that could be a topic of discussion. I think maybe where it's a little more unclear, where we had more questions, was around the hours for secretary professions. And I think you'd already discussed kind of what secretary professions are before, Ashley, but specifically for those professions, like massage therapy, I think would be an example of that, or what could be some other ones? Counselors, I think, would probably also fall into that. And whether it would be helpful to specify for those professions in this rulemaking the number of hours, knowing or expecting that the boards and commissions would be specifying the hours in their own rulemakings. And whether a kind of an analog question to that is whether the health equity continuing education credits is going to be in addition to currently required CE requirements. You know, if the profession requires 20 continuing education credits every 2 years, is this going to be an additional amount of credits, or is this going to be built into those 20 credits? I think our expectation is that board and commissions would be making those decisions, but whether this rulemaking should cover those questions for the secretary of professions. So I don't know if I answered anything. I think I just asked more questions, but.
Yes. And so with this, we're really looking at those professions that require continuing education, but don't have their own rulemaking authority, like a board or commission. So off the top of my head, I believe, you know, like your substance use disorder professionals, your licensed counselors, so that would be your licensed marriage and therapy, marriage and therapy individuals, or your licensed clinical independent, you know, social workers are one, your licensed marriage and family therapist. There's a whole list of professions out there where they're not a board or commission, but a secretary's profession. And so when we talk about boards and commissions, we might talk about the medical commission, the nursing commission. Those are in a board would be, you know, the psychology, then the board of psychology. Those ones are all their own rulemaking entity, profession. And so they'll address this work in their own roles, or maybe they just decide to adopt what we talk about today. So we're really drilling down those other professions that are really going to nod towards the work we're doing today. And so reading the comments, and I apologize, I got far behind on this. So will the training every 4 years? So people can pick their own trainings, but every 4 years they must address the newest topics, the leading information, and learn about this topic of health equity every 4 years. Some individuals might decide to do that, even know a little bit of the hours every single year. And then you have the ones that say, you know what, I need to get 40 hours in all my continuing education. I'm going to take a week off of work before my renewal and do all 40 hours there. I think that's more of a personal choice, unless it's written in rule to dictate that, but the bill does say every 4 years. And so that training changes as new information comes out, programs might adjust how they provide that training or what they, you know, what topics they cover, as long as they're meeting what we put in rule and, you know, they can exceed it, they can go beyond it. Also, Ross, you said every 5 years, the department tends to look over its rules. Is that correct?
Yes, there is a 5 year rule review. I believe that comes from a statute that directs the department, I think, among other agencies, to do a review of their rules. And I could be missing some of the finer points there, but that's my understanding. So likely within the context of that 5 year review, this rule could be reviewed to see, for example, if any of the content that's specified has become outdated, or if additional information needs to be added in. And that's, of course, in addition to, you know, the department has the ability to reopen the rule if it needs to be amended or if there's a purpose. And there's also options for the public to petition the department to open a rule, you know, if there's a reason to do so. So there's a few different ways that rules can be updated after this rulemaking is concluded.
So I'm seeing that it says, a lot of people say there should be a minimum number of hours specified in the rules. Someone, you know, throughout the question, every 4 years, is that often enough to make headway in healthcare equity? And then someone brought up the minimum hours might need to be discussed after finalizing the minimum content. I doubt you can meaningfully address all of health equity components in 1 to 2 hours. And there's a yes to that. Now, someone asked, you know, is this on top of our own requirements? And I really want to address that. This is not, how can I put this? Right now, as this is written, it is not on top of the actual requirements. It can be rolled into those requirements. Prior to my work here at the department, I was in a profession that required continuing education. And so oftentimes what we do is normally it's defined that you must cover these topics, but this many hours needs to be in something. And then I have this leeway really to do continuing education in areas that really spoke to me or maybe honed in on my specialty. And so when you look at this type of requirement, what we're saying is this many hours of your continuing education work must be in the topic of health equity. So versus defining part of those hours, that requirement must be in this topic of health equity and must address these topics. And that's really how it's laid out right now. So with this, we'll kind of think about it, but let's move on to the next section and just know that we will readdress what this hour looks like later on. So Ross, unless there's any questions further. Okay, so this is the training content section. And what we did was we pulled out some of the conversations and some of the direction that the bill gave us. And so Ross, if you were to go down a little bit so that we can get probably the most in here. So section one or part one of this, right, really talks about what this training must require. And then two says, hey, it must assess the licensee, which that's language that we already talked about. So let's highlight that, Ross. And then we'll make sure it matches the rest of the sections. But it must get at their ability to apply these into practice. So we'll discuss that a little bit as well. And then finally, three, it says the course topics may include, but are not limited to. And so I really want to ask some questions about that language, because that's what the bill says. It says it may include, but it's not limited to. So do we want to use that language? Or is it kind of the topics need to include these? And so we'll incorporate a little bit from what we learned from our listening sessions into that section. But first, just to begin with, I want to open it up a little bit more broadly. And so does anyone have any questions or comments that they would like to say in this about this section in general? And I'll go ahead and call on you. So there's a great comment in the section. Should it be must include, but not limited to? So that would be number three there, Ross. And so it'll be really important too that we look at what this topic is, because the bill language said it may include, but it's not limited to. But as soon as we change it to must include, but it's not limited to, these topics must be addressed in that continuing education, even though we can go above and beyond. So perhaps maybe the question is this list actually complete? What should be added to or maybe taken away, expanded on? These are a lot of topics. If I were to say must, it's too much to fit into a few hours of training. Gail, you have your hand up. And you are on mute.
So sorry. Thank you. I'm just thinking about this along with all of you. And I think first, it is important to adhere to statutory language, but also kind of a broader, and you know, I'm sure there are others on this call that would be able to think about this, you know, that have much more experience than I do. I'm just thinking that I'm guessing there won't be just one course that does all of this necessarily, that these are all very important issues. And I mean, I'm just wondering how you're envisioning this. I mean, folks are to get some health equity CE every 4 years. And I'm guessing that, you know, at one point they may take some training with one particular focus, another 4 years, it might be another focus. Maybe they do others in between. So I think if you put must in, then every single course has to have all of these parts and pieces. And I'd be interested to hear what those who are more expert in how these courses might work, you know, whether that's reasonable or workable.
Right. Any other comments or anyone would like to speak up? We have Jesse. Go ahead.
Well, I'm not an expert in these types of trainings, but I feel like when we have required trainings, the list is a mile long of everything they have to touch on. It moves it from the realm of, yes, as Abby's saying in the comments, like very broad and not very deep, but also like very kind of boring, right? Like I'm being forced to engage in this topic in a really particular way rather than being allowed and encouraged to engage with it in the ways that work for me, given my expertise or my interests or my specific part of the field. And so I think keeping it flexible actually encourages people to engage more meaningfully, if that makes sense, because they can tailor it to what they need to improve their own practice.
We have a few agrees. Any other comments? Anyone else want to grab the mic? And
I'm sorry, this is Annie and I just jumped in. May I speak?
Oh yes, go ahead.
Okay. I'm grappling with the fact that we have a long history of when allowed to do whatever we want to do in this country, we allow racism to continue to be destructive and oppress people. So I really feel strongly that we should have some minimum topics. They could be simplified from this. I don't think we have to make the whole list be a must, but you know, I think at least the implicit bias training it's a place where everyone should start. At the very least. So I would beg you to consider making some of the training topics be required to start with, and then maybe provide some flexibility for going deeper. But I do think we need to set some minimum standards.
All right. I see that there's Michelle.
Hi, thanks. I just wanted to kind of piggyback off that. A lot of these topics are at the individual level, the interpersonal level, and the institutional and structural level. So it's covering all these different levels in which oppression exists in all these different areas. So I guess my question would be, is there a focus area or a narrower scope that you would want to include in here for maybe what could be mandatory or beginning at one level? I know in general, you're talking about structural competencies. And so you're gonna have to get to the structural and the institutional level at some point. You may start with the interpersonal and the individual levels and then move to, that's why I asked the question about scaffolding. Could it be, you know, we build knowledge on top of each other, beginning at the individual level and ultimately taking up to the structural level.
Okay, so how about this, Ross? And this is me being wild in my thoughts and just putting an idea out there for you. But what if there was perhaps another number, right? Like a 3A perhaps, and it says it must include these courses, and then 3B, it can or it may include, but it's not limited to, and then we leave this list as written. And of course, this is just other ideas. You guys can shoot me down and it won't hurt me at all, but maybe we just identify these core ideas, these core topics, and say the training must include A, B, and C, and topics may include, but they're not limited to. So at least we can work through from small, from individual to this bigger realm, which is what I'm hearing Michelle say. Michelle, your hand is back up.
Yeah, I'm trying to think about that question. I wanted to ask, is there an expected outcome? Like in 5 years, we expect to minimize something. So I better know how to respond to the question.
There wasn't a suspected income. There was almost like a hope, right? So with me understanding more about my biases, and I have them, right? I can then reduce the inequities with the people I reach. Maybe I can change my business practice. And so I'm changing kind of that culture of that organization to be more equitable in the things I do. And then hopefully that work will just reduce it all around. And I'm not sure if that really answers a question that you had, but the bill really had a lot of hope in it, but not a very pinpointed outcome, if that makes sense.
Okay, I think because the more complicated and the more information you get in here, the more difficult it is to measure that ultimate outcome and the more difficult it is to obtain any form of success.
Ross, if you go to the beginning of this section, it will actually say a longer, it says these skills enable a healthcare professional to act or to care effectively for patients from diverse cultures, groups, and communities, varying in race, ethnicity, gender identity, sexuality, religion, age, ability, social economic status, and other categories of identity. And from our listening sessions, really, if we look broadly, we had people, advocates and individuals with lived experience really hit on these core topics and say, hey, it's not happening. And as a result, I'm experiencing these inequities. And so I think that's really what the goal is how do we reduce those barriers and give people the resources they need? How do I recognize that as a professional so that I ensure that these resources individuals need are present so people can have great care, good care in Washington? So I'm not sure if that answered it or any of your thoughts. Michelle, do you still have some comments?
I guess I am. I'm really trying to get at efficacy, you know, because we could get lost. We could have for example, if we decided the health department, which we will, so we did or implemented this training, we would expect to be able to measure some kind of knowledge building from that particular kind of training and then feed that back to the health department in Washington. You say, okay, we have some correlation between the differences in negative experiences with our patients and the increase in training that our providers or practitioners have had. So I was just kind of trying to get at that because I think a lot of us are going to be looking at forms of measuring this kind of success, or if we're going to tackle a problem this large, that maybe we tackle it in small increments so that we can measure that success over time. So that was the point I was trying to make. Will there be anything wrapped up in this writing that speaks to accountability?
Hope, Ross, do you have any thoughts? Or even Omar?
This is Ross. We have a section, I believe it's this next section, that discusses training quality. I think this is more aimed specifically at evaluating the trainer from the course itself, as well as kind of the participants' experience in that course. So I'm not sure if that gets at exactly what Michelle was discussing in terms of having a true measure. And I don't know if measure would include like a test or some other type of evaluation that could determine progress or what was learned. But all we have at this point on that point is really this training quality section.
Ashley, this is Chris. Do you want to jump in?
Go ahead, but you sound kind of robot-y.
Is this better at all?
This is much better.
Okay, sorry. I just want to say I really appreciate that question, and I think it's an important question. I think the thing to keep in mind is the bill didn't direct us to do that, and so of course we didn't get funded to do that. That doesn't mean that we can't think of ways that we might want to somehow measure the efficacy of the training in the future. And so I wouldn't say we're taking off the table, but it's definitely something for us to keep in mind at this point. It's just something that, you know, we're required to do.
Chris, we're losing you in the end.
Okay.
The tinfoilness is increasing. I think we may have lost Chris. So I think to kind of sum up what she was saying is the bill really doesn't point us at really being able to measure this, but there's some stuff we can do in terms of writing, but really we don't have the funding nor the direction. And I'm not sure, maybe Ross, you could clarify a little more.
I would need to look at the bill again, specifically. I think, I would need to look at the bill again, I think, to know, and that this is also a topic that we could probably discuss with our Assistant Attorney General to kind of see what the limits of this rulemaking are and what we can do, as well as what Chris mentioned about, you know, our capacity to be able to do it in terms of measuring and getting feedback and assessments of these courses and how well participants are learning from these courses. So I think that that's something that we probably need to take back and reflect on and get some more answers.
So yeah, if you can make a comment, Ross, we'll get more information and take the comments we have so far and see if we can get more direction to give individuals and participation and bring it back what we did learn during our second workshop. Does that sound like a good plan of action for those of you who are in attendance? We got a yes, a thumbs up. So we'll go ahead and do that, Ross, and then we'll just move to the next section. Because this might also inform this section a little bit as well. There was some pretty good comments in the chat. You know, testing's really not going to really meet someone's ability to apply the knowledge, even though it might test that they have the knowledge. And so this new section is very, like I said, very much taken from the suicide prevention. And it was really looking at this minimum requirements or this minimum standard for training quality. And really, how do we evaluate it to make sure that this training meets what we want? And can we get the font a little bigger, Ross? And then also, it's important for us to note here that this was really a copy and a paste. Nothing is really concrete here. We just really wanted something to jog conversation about this. So when you look at the degree requirements, that is something that really we just put in as a placeholder. And really, are people maybe with lived experience able to teach this? Or do we want to leave it to a healthcare professional or whatnot? And so just remember that what we do here can increase or decrease the amount of training programs or the people who can teach, you know, this information to our professionals. And so I guess maybe the first question is really centered around, what does training quality actually look like? And this feeds into the conversation we had. What are evaluations? So, and do we even need sections of this, like bullet points? So I'll kind of leave it there and look for anyone who wants to discuss or have a conversation maybe surrounding any aspect of this or the training quality as a whole. Let's see, someone's talking about outcomes. Okay. I'll keep that in mind. Thank you for that comment. How about this? Number one. Oh, we got a hand up. Annie.
Yeah, I'm thinking that I'm not sure that you need to be a healthcare professional to provide this training. I'm not sure how many people out there are healthcare professionals who have enough experience and knowledge to deliver that training, but I think it needs to be someone who has experience with health equity and the concepts. So, and that may not be the best way to phrase that, but it does need to be someone who can apply the concepts around equity to the healthcare setting and the healthcare experience. And maybe someone here has a better way of expressing what I'm trying to say, but.
All right, any other comments? And thank you for that.
else. And I'll remember to take my hand down this time.
I just wanted an excuse to call on you again. There's a great comment too in the box. I've had good and bad trainers with degrees and those with lived experience. So with that comment, do we need to be limiting? Do we want to be more open? Is it more about maybe the content of the training and not who's delivering the content? So courses should be at least developed with input from those who've had lived experience with healthcare and inequities. Someone says it's more about the content, not the provider. And someone's thinking about how lived experience may fit in here. I like the idea of being more open in terms of educational background. So are we saying we don't want B, at least? We don't want B. Or maybe we don't want to define who that individual is. We want to focus on maybe the content. So Jesse says, I think licensed professional or educational background or lived experience. Someone says, no, B. B is not necessary. Someone says the content is most important, but should be critical or credible. So do we need this section at all?
I think it would be good to have someone who can demonstrate some competency towards delivering the subject matter, because I think a lot of people could put together a really nice package that makes it look like their content is really great, but they have to be able to deliver it. So, and I don't have a good idea of how you would be able to determine competency, but I think the comment above that talks about lived experience, educational background, or is a great way to frame that. It gives you that leeway of, and then you might need to, as DOH or whoever implements this needs to determine a rubric or a way of evaluating that competency.
Okay. Ross, did you get that? I know you're doing your magic.
No, I apologize. I think I was too worried about shuffling comments. Would you mind repeating that? I apologize.
I think it's more about being competency-based, if that's a nice way to wrap it up. So, and there is a comment in here that talks about having the criteria with an or rather than an, just those are some examples of people who could present, but not limiting yourself to that, because there are people with lived experience out there who have no degrees who could do an amazing job of delivering this, right? So having a competency-based rubric for determining who can deliver.
So instead of putting all the ors, then right. Do we even need A?
Good question. Let's see.
Because removing A may also get to the same point as I think a licensed professional or educational background or someone with lived experience. But that really also defines who can provide it without limiting it. I guess if you removed it, then anyone could perform that. So there is some risk both ways.
I think I would say something like, if it were just me replacing it, I would say something like a facilitator or training developers must demonstrate competence in delivering health equity training content.
So how do we ensure quality? Will DOH endorse these trainings? Someone says they don't see the connection between having a license and having knowledge to develop or teach health equity. And someone else said, I think there needs to be some expectation of the ability for the person to teach as well as have knowledge. And so that actually gets to my next question, right? Which is C, what level of experience delivering training and health equity? Perhaps that's the qualifiers that not only are you able to develop, but maybe you also have experience in delivering this training. And how do we actually define that? Is it a year? Is it maybe some past demonstration? What are your thoughts on that? Well, I'll let you think about it. Oh, there we go. We got some comments coming in. Certify specific training that includes trainer competency. It would be nice to have an entity review and signal what is quality training. There's some agreeance in there. So what I would do in that case, Ross, is release this, copy those comments in, and then we can discuss it a little later, and then bring some information back to this next workshop in regards to that. Trainers that can display evidence-based training outcomes. That's a good one as well. All right. Let's see what we have next. So we have the training approval process. And what's after that, Ross? That's it?
Yes, this is the last section.
All right. It would be nice if trainers, content, what do we just got to blast the three comments. Four. So, and he said, it would be nice if trainers' content really delivers training in a way that understands how disparities impact health equity. It's already challenging to find good unconscious bias training out there. I would be reluctant to narrow it too far. Have scaffolded learning and something. All right. DOH. A lot of good comments. I was just giving a moment for us to read them all. So trainers can be coaches outside the health system, but more towards human and human understanding. Do we know of anything that is available that we could think could be used to describe training? I've been searching and this one's interesting. Yeah, we'll definitely look over that. And also in the interest of time, we should probably start closing out. So what I'll do is I'll take the comments and I'll give myself an assignment surrounding this as well. And so Leslie, what I'll do is I'll research some training programs that are also available, as well as review the one you put in the chat. And then I'll be able to speak on some of the programs that I know are available in this realm so that we kind of have something to look at. So let me write that down, or maybe even Ross, you can write that down as well. And the next workshop, we'll go over some of the information I found. We'll talk a little bit about what the department's role is in approving these trainings. And then we'll spend more time on the training quality and the training topics. Hopefully I'll have some responses back from our AAG so I can answer some of the questions that we had. And it's really important to note that these workshops build off of each other. So they're not, so if you have friends or family or other associations, whoever that wants to participate in this, it'll be important to let them know that they build off of each other. This is a collaborative process, and hopefully, you know, by the third workshop, we'll have this product. Thank you so much for the information. And, you know, we'll go to the next topic real quick, which is Hope or Ross, if you want to talk about the next steps in the draft process.
Sure, I can real quickly mention it. So we will be having, I'm not sure, Ashley, if you have the next date for our rules workshop handy, but as Ashley mentioned, we will take back this draft and the comments that are included and try and answer the questions and try and update this draft based upon the comments. So when we meet next time, we'll have more to discuss and we can discuss the changes that we've made. And we also will send out the updated copy prior to the next rules workshop, similar to how we did with this rules workshop. So you have time to review. And then we will do a similar meeting as we did today, where we'll go through the rule. We'll probably spend a little less time with discussing background and so forth, and jump right into the rules and probably really honing in on identifying and developing what the minimum standards for these continuing education programs are, and spend quite a bit of time there, as well as this last section, training approval process, and discussing that next time. So please feel free to email us any comments or questions you have on this draft or on the process in general. And again, thank you for your time today.
Thank you for that. So our next meeting is going to be March 21st. It is a little earlier, so it starts at 1 p.m. and ends at 3 p.m. Like I said, we'll answer any other questions you may have. You can submit your comments, questions, thoughts, if something else comes to your mind, through the email that I also put in the chat. So we do check those pretty regularly, and I like to respond. So thank you so much for your contributions. Everything is written down and will be considered, and hopefully we'll have some answers for you the next time. And I'll just stick around a little bit longer and see if there's any questions. But at this point, this workshop is adjourned, and I'll see you next time. Okay. I see no other questions, Dan. So you can go ahead and shut it down if you want.
Do. I will shut it down and then nice job, Ashley. Really nice job. And then I will start getting the video transferred over and all of that.
And Dan, will these comments will be preserved?
Yes.
As well, is that right? Okay.
Yep. Yep.
Thank you, Dan.
You betcha. And I will also get for Mina the attendance and all of that.
Ashley, you're muted.
I will hand you a gov delivery to go out probably either next week, probably next Monday.
Sounds great. We'll get it out.
Thank you, guys. Thank you for attending.